for the Vesper service, giving of ourselves. The opening verse comes from Mark 8, verse 35. If you try and hang on to your life, you will lose it. But if you give up your life for my sake, and for the sake of the good news, you will save it. The opening song, What If I Gave All?
Thank you. to some of our regular services, you know that the song that we just heard is referencing a scripture that I love talking about, especially here in my day. That story of that boy who had enough lunch for himself, 5 loaves, 2 fishes, who saw a need that was vast, right? Thousands. And who said, well, I guess I'll give the tiny bit that I have, I'll give all of it. And Jesus took it and used it to feed the whole multitude. That story, which that song was reflecting on, is a model for you and I. Everything in us, when we face similar circumstances, says it is pointless, stupid, counterproductive, worthless, useless to give all that I've got in the face of such a vast need. All I will do is hurt myself and help nobody. Might as well look out for myself. Look out for number one, right? We live in a neighborhood with lots of needs. And it's really easy to let our hearts grow cold. And when we see the need around us, we think, well, I gotta look out for myself first. I'll hold on to what I've got. Because, hey, I could give what I've got to this person, this need that I see in front of me, but there'll be another need tomorrow, and another need tomorrow, and another need tomorrow. I might as well get this. And that does make total, perfect sense. It does. That's how math works. But you know, God is bigger than what makes sense. He can do stuff that we can't do. He can make 2 + 2 = 5,000. Or at least he can make 5 + 2, 5 loaves, 2 fish, be enough for 5,000. And when we dare to be generous, when we dare to risk what we have to give it away, man, oh man, that's when the fun part of being a disciple kicks in. Because we see God work miracles and do what we just can't when we hold on to our stuff. Here, in this opening phase of our service, we're going to pray a prayer of confession. And I certainly need this confession today, and I need to speak this confession, because I do that all the time. I hold on. I get fearful. I get mistrustful. I don't give. I don't open up. I don't share. And I can get just as cynical as the next person. Telling us to do different, to be generous. And he's telling us, he tells us again and again in scriptures, there is blessing for us if we do it. So I'm going to pray this prayer of confession with my lips. I ask you to pray it in your heart. And then we'll respond to it with the words together below. Almighty and most merciful Father, we have erred and strayed from your ways like lost sheep. We have followed too much the devices and desires of our own hearts. We have offended against your holy laws. O Lord, have mercy upon us. Spare those who confess their faults. Restore those who are repentant, according to your promises declared to mankind in Christ Jesus our Lord. And grant, O most merciful Father, for his sake, that we may hereafter live a godly, righteous, and sober life to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Respond together with these words. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins through Jesus Christ our Lord, and strengthen us to live in the power of the Holy Spirit all our days.
First reading this evening comes from Psalm 25. O Lord, I give my life to you. I trust in you, my God. Do not let me be disgraced, or let my enemies rejoice in my defeat. No one who trusts in you will ever be disgraced, but disgrace comes to those who try to deceive others. Show me the right path, O Lord, point out the road for me to follow. Let me be your truth. Lead me by your truth and teach me. For you are the God who saves me. All day long I put my hope in you. Remember, O Lord, your compassion and unfailing love, which you have shown from long ages past. Do not remember the rebellious sins of my youth. Remember me in the light of your unfailing love. For you are merciful, O Lord. The Lord is good and does what is right. He shows the proper path to those who go astray. He leads the humble in doing right, teaching them his way. The Lord leads with unfailing love and faithfulness all who keep his covenant and obey his commands. For the honor of your name, O Lord, forgive my many, many sins. Who are those who fear the Lord? He will show them the path they should choose. They will live in prosperity, and their children will inherit the land. The Lord is a friend to those who fear him. He teaches them his covenant. My eyes are always on the Lord, for he rescues me from the traps of my enemies. Turn to me and have mercy, for I am alone and in deep distress. My problems go from bad to worse. Oh, save me from them all. Feel my pain and see my trouble. Forgive all my sins. See how many enemies I have and how viciously they hate me. Protect me. Rescue my life from them. Do not let me be disgraced, for in you I take refuge. May integrity and honesty protect me, for I put my hope in you. O God, ransom Israel from all its troubles. Let us join together in this line. O God, make speed to save us. O Lord, make haste to help us.
Our second psalm reading comes from Psalm 100. And we usually turn the corner with the second psalm, and there was a cry for God to help. And now we turn to a shout of joy, which is the very beginning phrase of this short, beautiful psalm that is itself kind of like this shout of joy. Psalm 100. Shout with joy to the Lord, all the earth. Hold on one second. I don't want you to think about this. Have you ever shouted with joy? Now, I bet you have. Now, it might be a long time since you have. But when I see kids, I know everybody here is a kid at one time or another shouted with joy. My little daughter, Julia, screams with joy. If you do certain things, I won't do this into the mic, because you would not want me to do this into the mic. But she shrieks with pure joy. Where does that come from, right? That's totally, you're not self-conscious at all if you're shouting with joy, right? It's like so deep in you, the joy is so powerful that you can't help but just let it out in this primal shout. Kids do it a lot. It's much rarer in us grown-ups because we're way more self-conscious than kids. But you know what? There's been some times in my even adult life where I've heard a piece of news so wonderful, or seen somebody I hadn't seen in a long time. I remember when I saw my brother when he was coming back from India. I picked him up at the airport. And I remember I saw him from a distance, and I shouted toward him. Not just to get his attention, but just truly in joy. Shouted his name in joy, right? Well, shout the name of the Lord, right? Shout out with joy. This is what is natural for us when we see God. When we see God at work in our lives, it's a cause for joy. The trick is that we so often allow our eyes, our spiritual eyes, to be gunked up. We don't see him in our daily life. We feel far from him. And every time we catch sight of him, we can shout with joy. God, thank you for being in my life. Thank you for delivering me. Thank you for helping me. Thank you for giving to me. Thank you for giving me a church family, for giving me your son Jesus. church, shout with joy to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come before him singing with joy. Acknowledge that the Lord is God. He made us and we are his. We are his people, the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving. Go into his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and praise his name. For the Lord is good. His unfailing love continues forever. And his faithfulness continues to each generation. One last word on that very final verse. We are living through such tumultuous times. I sometimes get up, and if I see the news on my phone or on the computer, I just feel a sense of shock at what a crazy year 2020 has been, and how disastrous in many ways, and how many sad, terrible, and difficult things have happened. So bad that sometimes you wonder what sort of permanent damages or changes might occur to communities, to the country, other things. I thought recently about a predecessor in the faith, a guy by the name of Augustine from a very, very far past generation. That last line of the psalm is, his mercy and his love is continues forever for every generation. There's no generation that's going to be abandoned by God. There's no generation where they're going to say, well, they're a write-off. God's not going to be able to help them. Everything's going to be a disaster for them. Augustine was living at a time where the Roman Empire was collapsing around him. This nation state that had existed for hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of years was literally falling down around him. In fact, when Augustine died, there was a barbarian army conquering his city in Rome, North Africa. And his whole life, everything he knew, the civilization he was a part of, was coming to an end. These guys were burning libraries, you know. Yeah. And as Augustine was dying, what he did was he put up a collection of psalms on his bed, on his bedside. And he turned his body to the wall. And these were psalms of repentance for himself. He wasn't angry, he wasn't scared either. But he said, as I get ready to die, I want to focus on turning my whole heart over to God. And he would read through these psalms of repentance with tears in his eyes. And he died in faith that even if the world as he knew it would come to an end, God would be faithful to future generations. The world he knew came to an end. The Roman Empire ceased to exist. The city he lived in was burned to a cinder. But what was never, ever threatened was the kingdom of God. And today we know his story. As we know the story of Jesus, his Lord and our Lord, and everything that matters, everything that has value, was safeguarded by God. It survives fire, it survives armies, it survives political dysfunction, it survives fighting and war. The kingdom cannot be touched by such things, because the love of God continues in faithfulness to every generation. The only question that remains for you and I is, will we, faced with disaster and trouble, shrink back, protect what little we have, try to protect our own little kingdom, or will we give all in order to invest in the kingdom which knows no end and which is not threatened by any disaster or calamity that this earth can throw at? So, brothers and sisters, I thank you for letting me expound upon that. We can respond to the good news of God. We can respond with our own shout of joy and praise in the doxology. And we have some recorded music that will help us do that. And as that begins to play, you can sing the doxology, which is on the next page over in your bulletin.
Yeah.
Gladsome light, pure brightness of the ever-living Father in heaven. O Jesus Christ, holy and blessed, now as we approach the setting of the sun, and our eyes behold the evening light, we sing your praises, O God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. You are worthy at all times to be praised by joyful voices, the Son of God, O giver of life, and to be glorified through all the world. The next song, Offering, which words are on the opposite page, is another way we praise God. And this song emphasizes the offering of giving ourselves.
Before you at this altar, so many
we give him everything. Even when by worldly logic it feels like, oh, it can't make a difference, it can't matter. Because he has already given us everything. And the logic of discipleship is laid out really clearly for us by Jesus himself in the following passage of Luke chapter 13, verses 25 through 33. A large crowd was following Jesus. He turned around and said to this crowd, if you want to be my disciple, right, not just a member of the crowd, you want to be my disciple, you must hate everyone else by comparison. Your father, mother, wife, and children, brothers and sisters, yes, even your own life. Otherwise, you cannot be my disciple. And if you do not carry your own cross and follow me, you cannot be my disciple. But don't begin until you count the cost. For who would begin construction of a building without first calculating the cost to see if there is enough money to finish it? Otherwise, you might complete only the foundation before running out of money, and then everyone would laugh at you. They would say, there's that person who started that building and couldn't afford to finish it. Or what king would go to war against another king without first sitting down with his council to discuss whether his army of 10,000 could defeat the 20,000 soldiers marching against him? And if he can, he will send a delegation to discuss terms of peace while that enemy is still far away. So you cannot become my disciple without giving up everything you own. One more scripture. This is coming from Philippians chapter 3, verses 8 to 11. This is why it's worth it to do that whole give up everything thing. Yes, everything else is worthless when compared with the infinite value of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord. For his sake, I have discarded everything else, counting it all as garbage, so that I could gain Christ and become one with him. I no longer count on my own righteousness through obeying the law. Rather, I become righteous through faith in Christ. For God's way of making us right with himself depends on faith. I want to know Christ and experience the mighty power that raised him from the dead. I want to suffer with him, sharing in his death, so that one way or another, I will experience the resurrection of the dead. Paul says he wants Christ so bad that everything else to him is garbage. He wants Christ so bad that he will face anything, do anything to get him. Is there something in your life that you want so bad you give up everything else? You know, the truth is, in every human life, there's that thing. For every human person, there's one thing that, practically speaking, will trump everything else. You will choose one thing over another, and one thing over that, and one thing over that, and something's going to come out on top of your life as your ultimate desire, your deepest aim. How fortunate, blessed, and wonderful it is if Jesus is the thing, the person, the one that you want more than anything else, because he is more valuable than this world put together. And to give up everything to get him is a bargain at that. So brothers and sisters, we're going to respond to this reading as we pray in our hearts with Susan, this prayer of the night.
Hear these words. Oh God, we thank you for helping us, loving us, showing us the way. Thank you for the new blessings, for forgiving us. Help us rededicate ourselves to you, Holy. We surrender our wills to your will. We give you back control of our lives. You are the only one who gives freely, giving love to anyone who asks. Help us to take up our cross and follow you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Jesus.
Benediction, if you would like prayer for anything, for healing, a prayer of confession, a prayer just expressing desire to get nearer to God, a prayer of surrender, a prayer for another, whatever it is. If you have something you need to bring to the altar, you can come up here and you could pray on your own. You could kneel if that's a kneeling thing. If you can, you can sit, you can stand. You can ask for prayer for me or Susan or a friend. But that'll be available, and we'll kind of, we need to make sure we clear the space around that prayer sign in case there is somebody that wants that. That's an invitation. After this benediction, feel free to come up here and pray. I do, brothers and sisters, bless you. That's what a benediction is. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, in the compassion of God, your Heavenly Father and mine, and in the wisdom and in the strength of the Holy Spirit, who is the one, who can awaken in you that desire for Jesus that's stronger than death itself, who can pull you toward him and inspire you to give all that you have to the one who's given everything for you. Go in that peace. Be well. Amen. Come up and pray if you need it.